Welcome, Rob DaCosta. Nice to have you here.
Nice to be with you.
Good to have you.
Yeah, the end of a crazy week, as we were just saying. So this is a nice way to have a chat and end the week on, I think.
It is. And we're going to be talking about self-running agencies, which I think is at the core of what you do at DaCosta Coaching. Before we get into that meaty topic, do you want to tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, what you do, who you do it for?
Yeah, sure. So if we can go back in time before a lot of people were even born, in the early 90s, I was the marketing manager for a small software company. And we really struggled to hire a good PR agency that understood what we did. So in my naive, arrogant, innocent, whatever youth, I thought, I know I could leave and start my own agency and focus on the tech sector, but bring that sort of understanding of tech. So I left my marketing job and I started my own agency, CITPR. That was in 92. And then over the next 11 years, we grew that largely by accident, I have to say. And mistakes, but we grew up to 25 staff, turning over about 1.5 million. And we made tons and tons of mistakes along the way, but we did a few things right. One of them, which was being always clear about who our niche was and who our target customer was. But anyway, I was liken it to this. We had a big open plan office on a farm, and I had that corner desk, you know, where you've got your back to the wall. And I felt towards the end of running the agency that everybody was coming with their wheelbarrows of crap and piling it at my desk every day. And I found myself dealing with everything but why I started the agency. And so I always like to say I had my midlife epiphany at about 38 and thought, I don't want to do this anymore. And we've been courted a couple of times by people to buyers. So we were in a really fortunate position when I decided to sell that we had two companies that wanted to buy us. So I sold the agency to a large US business and did my 2-year prison sentence with them, my 2-year earnouts. And I know anybody that's watching this that has perhaps been an entrepreneur and sold their business will know that often that isn't a particularly happy marriage when you sell. And this particular company killed our brand straight away and just took our people and our clients and our and so on. So at the end of those 2 years, I left. Actually, they offered me to buy the agency back for £1. And I said, no, thank you, because really what they wanted me to do was take the people off of their hands. And I didn't want to do that. So I then thought, what am I going to do with the rest of my life? And anyway, the kind of universe collided and I got into coaching. So I spent a couple of years retraining and then started DaCosta Coaching back in 2007. And I'm actually just entering year 15 now. And yeah, and so, you know, I help SME agency owners grow their businesses in a profitable, sustainable and enjoyable way. And I always make sure I add that last part onto that phrase, because it's so important that we focus on enjoying the journey and not just focusing on a destination. And, you know, like I said, when I ran my agency, I made lots of mistakes and didn't have the kind of support that you offer and I offer to people that wasn't really available back in the 90s. So I learned as I stumbled my way and learned my lessons the hard way, like a lot of people do. And so I guess I'm on a mission now to sort of help people not make those same mistakes that I made.
Yeah. And you know, this enjoyment thing, this fun thing, it's, I don't know, sometimes agency owners can feel a little bit guilty about doing the kind of things that they enjoy because they need to self-flagellate. You know, I need to do all the grind. But actually, if the business benefits from the thing that you're passionate about and are good at doing, that's a hell of a sweet spot. It's a hell of a catalyst.
For sure. And also, I remember, Jannes, early on, one of my first clients was actually one of my old employees who'd left and started his own agency. And I remember having a chat with him. This is a long time ago. And he said to me, we were doing some vision work. And he said to me, you know what, I've had a chat with my wife and we both acknowledge that it's going to be really hard slog for the next 2 years. But at the end of that 2 years, we're planning to start family and hopefully I'll be at the stage I want to be by that point and then it will get better. And it was like this thing in the future. And I was like, but you know, Fred, that's not his name, but you know, what happens, Fred, if you never get to the 2 years? Would it have been worth having this really difficult time? And like I say, I think a lot of people get fixated or even seduced by the promise of whatever that light at the end of the tunnel is, and they forget that they are allowed to enjoy the journey. And I think one thing that I learned when I ran my own business is that, you know, you have this entrepreneurial spark that is the reason why you start your business. But if you're not careful, you end up creating a monster that you end up working for. And of course, you're the worst boss that you would have ever had. So I think it's so important to make sure that you, you know, stop and smell the roses, that you get to a point where you can pick and choose the things that you love doing. And like you say, when you do something that you're passionate about, it just exudes out of you, and the clients can sense that, and your team can sense that, and so on. So it just makes life a lot easier.
Yeah, and I'd go so far to say it's probably necessary. Anybody can run a business when the going's good. You know, I could set up an agency, and my 10-year-old son, I think, could run it. But when the chips are down and COVID's hitting and clients are leaving us and we've got to be getting up early and putting the extra hours in, if we don't love it, that's a really long slog. The business is probably going to suffer. The visionary piece and moving the company forward is going to suffer. And there's only so many times we can go through those troughs, I think. And
yeah.
So I think it's pretty crucial, isn't it? I think to love.
It is, but I guess the flip side of that is to acknowledge that there are always things that we don't love doing, but they have to be done. And at that point, we have three choices maybe. One of them is just do them. One of them is delegate them, and then the other one is automate them or change your systems if you can. But the worst thing we can do is ignore those things. I had an interesting session with someone today, someone this week who is a journalist, and he's just jumped onto the other side of working as an account manager in an agency. And he just doesn't get it. He's a fantastic writer, of course, and he really knows how to pitch to the media, but the whole kind of agency, you know, what it means. And we were talking about some of their team members, and he was saying, and I was saying, you know, what would you say to people in your team that don't do tasks that they need to be doing, but they focus on the things they're really good at? And he was saying, well, I think that's what they should do. And I was like, okay, well, that's interesting thought, because if you think everybody should only do those things and not the administrative aspects of their job, then you're going to end up with anarchy and chaos. So although I think we need to enjoy the journey, we also need to look at the whole aspect of running our business and recognize there are things that have to be done, like your accounts or all those things that we may not like doing. And if you don't do them, then you're going to have all sorts of challenges. So if in that case, try to delegate them, automate them, or just get on and do them.
Yeah. We were talking about VAs before we came online, and I have a wonderful VA in Claire who, you know, runs me certainly. And the business for me through lots of systems and automation and that kind of thing. And those things that I really, really hate doing myself, I've even delegated the accountability, even if it's me that does them. And the last thing I want to do is actually think about doing them.
Yeah.
I've given Claire, part of Claire's process is to remind me 5 times throughout the day on a Monday to do the thing. And the fifth message, you know, you have permission to swear at me by this point, you know, to really get my ass into gear to go get
all,
them done.
I tell you what, we all need Claire. We all absolutely need to Claire. And you and I were just saying, those people are gold dust because, you know. But there is a good example of like delegating those tasks that have to be done and breaking down some of the stories that we tell ourselves about delegation. I find myself doing this, even though I teach my clients all the time. It's not quicker to do it yourself. You're asking yourself the wrong question if people will do it as well as you. That's the wrong question. It's, will they do it well enough? And if you always think, oh, it's just quicker to do it myself than show someone else, then you're going to end up with a lot of weight on your shoulders and a lot of kind of crappy tasks that you really don't want to do. And that ultimately leads you to falling out of love with your agency. So not a good thing.
And the reality is, right, that we when we actually map these processes out, these things that we think we are inherently involved with, we're not really. There's only 20% of it where we need to turn up, and the rest of it is task oriented and could be templated and delegated and followed.
For sure. It's interesting. I posted something on LinkedIn this week that mentioned something about the agency owner should be delegating as much client work as they possibly can, and then someone commented on this. That's really interesting, Rob. Why do you think that? Surely the agency owners should be doing that stuff. It's like, no, because at the end of the day, if you want to scale in some way, whether that be hiring in-house team or using remote workers, you have to get some of that stuff off your plate. And you also have to ask yourself, are you doing the things that only you can do? Not are you doing the things that you can do better than anybody else, because we all arrogantly think we can do it better than everybody else, but are you doing the things that only you can do? And as an agency owner, that usually looks like plotting the future of your agency, the business development, all that kind of stuff, and the strategic aspect of client management, but not certainly not the, you know, the day-to-day stuff, because ultimately you're going to want to have a team who are better at doing it than you are.
Yeah. So this leads us very nicely into the self-running agency, because it's, you know, the, what you've just described there is a situation where it's not running itself, you know, where we're holding all of the relationships with the clients, doing a lot of the work and a lot of the admin. What does a self-running agency look like?
Yeah, well, let me just tell you how that sort of term came about. So last year I spent some time doing some proper in-depth interviews with my audience. Some, I don't know if you've heard of the concept of jobs to be done, but trying to understand what are the jobs that an agency owner is trying to get done when they hire someone like me or you. And and what came out of that was this desire to grow an agency that's less dependent on them. And what a lot of agency owners find is they have this aspiration when they start their agency of what they want to build and what they want it to be. But they find themselves more intrinsically stuck in the agency the bigger they get. And it's absolutely the opposite of their intent. So the self-running agency is a concept or an aspiration. And it's not that everybody wants to build a self-running agency, but people want to build an agency that is less based on them and an agency that gives them flexibility and freedom without losing control. So that's the sort of concept behind it. And I guess the key concepts are about putting the structures in place in what I see as three core areas in order for you to get stuff off your plate and to have the flexibility and freedom that you want without having to relinquish control, which doesn't mean not delegating. So the three kind of key components of the self-running agency are all about planning. That's the first key component. The second key component is all about business. So that's, you know, where are you getting your new business from in the future? And then the third key area is about team. So that's developing a team, because you won't be able to build any kind of self-running agency if you don't put some kind of team in place. So those are the three kind of component parts that make up the self-running agency. And as I said, that term came about through just talking to a lot of people in our world and seeing what the common issues were and the common challenges and what they were really trying to achieve, and finding out, you know, as you'll know, that people often get the opposite of what they want, because like I say, the bigger they get, the more involved they're in and everything, and the harder they find to let go. I think entrepreneurs are sort of amazing because they have this sort of energy about them and these ideas, but they're also control freaks as well. So often people don't like letting go. And you know, if you want to sign off on everything, if you want to be involved in everything, then your clients are going to want you to be involved in everything, and you're never going to step away from it. And then that will lead you to stress, long working hours. And like for me, waking up one day and go, what on earth am I doing? This is not. And you know, I guess for me, and a little bit for you, I think, you know, grey hair makes you wiser, because, you know, you realise in the end that money isn't the be all and end all of everything, and that can't be the driving force behind what you do, because, you know, if you just follow the money, you'll never be happy. If you follow the passion, the money will follow, hopefully. So I think that's what the concept of the self-running agency is, and that term seems to resonate with a lot of people. The people that are in my program and who work with me are sort of typically people who have been running their agency for a while, perhaps have hit a brick wall in terms of growth, and they don't really know how to get over that. They take that one step forward and one step back. So they reach out to people like us to help them get beyond that, and then to start putting the systems and processes and structures in place to build this agency that ultimately is less dependent on them.
Yeah. And what, so if I had a helicopter view, and I have two petri dishes, helicopter looking into a petri dish, one was a non self-running agency, one was, you know, probably the stereotypical agency, what might I see as being different? When I look at the self-running agency, what kind of tangible, I don't know, activities or practices or things might be in place there that we don't see in the other petri dish?
Yeah, so number one, having a really clear vision that you communicate to the agency buys into it. So we all know where we're headed, We all want to go in that direction. I often say to people, look, if you don't have a clear vision, it's just in your head or you don't even think about it. You know, you might want to go to the south of France, but some of your other team members might want to head to Scotland. And in that case, we're going to have all sorts of problems. We're never going to get anywhere. So I think having a clear vision that everybody buys into and that you turn into a strategy and into a sort of a monthly plan for your agency is the first thing you would see. The second thing you would see is a team that sits beneath the owner, and this is like a senior leadership team or a management team, whatever you want to call it, who the owner can delegate the delivery of a lot of aspects of that vision to, so that they are, like I say, focusing on the things that they're really great at, which is planning and business development and so on. And then I think the third thing would be robust, repeatable systems in place that mean, you know, we've got consistent marketing and business development strategies in place, so we're not going through feast and famine. We understand who our ideal target customer is, so that we're finding those people because we have better relationships, we're more successful, they pay us more money. I think the other thing I would say is being really clear about your niche, being really clear about your ideal customer, and hopefully charging based on value, not based on time and, you know, fixed project fees and so on. So I think those are the things, as opposed to another kind of agency where you've got the leader here, you've got everybody else here, the leader's perhaps controlling everything, is the puppeteer of everything, there's probably, you know, they're probably a generalist, there's probably a high turnover of clients, probably a high turnover of staff. I mean, I'm giving you two very extreme sort of examples of that. Of course, there are many in between, but I think that's what I would see. I don't know whether you would concur with that or...
I'm really happy that you mentioned the niche word. I think it's, I'm going to bang on about niches again. People who watch this are probably sick of me talking about it, but it's...
Me too.
Yeah, it's, if we do everything for everybody, it's really hard to get good at anything. You know, we can't write a marketing plan, so we can never scale our marketing and our lead gen. We can't get good at the stuff that we do internally because all of our clients have slightly different needs. Whereas this niching thing is, hey, we're working with these people, they require these things. We're going to deliver these things at scale. I'm going to say no to all this other stuff. And now we can get good and better and more efficient at it. And that's where real scale comes from. And, you know, you can't, I heard this said once that you can't get good until you're first consistent. You know, you can't get better until you're first consistent. Otherwise, you might get lucky, maybe, but that's not a plan. So that consistency comes through the niching.
And it's really interesting. I don't know if you see this as well, Yannis, but it's really interesting how many agencies are resistant about this. They tell themselves these stories like, if I niche, I will lose all these other opportunities. And I'm like, well, how many of these other opportunities are you winning? And the really, really simple thing about niching is that a generalist will always be able to charge less than a specialist. You know, I always say if I needed knee surgery, I wouldn't go to my GP, I would go to a knee surgeon specialist. And if both of those were charging, guess who charges more money? And when you're a specialist, it becomes much easier for your target audience to find you and to say, you're the person I want to work with. Whereas if you're a generalist, you're typically differentiating yourself by either being cheaper or by promising crazy levels of service. And both of those are a race to the bottom. And both of those are a recipe for stress and being an unprofitable business. And the other thing I think is that I sometimes talk to people and they say, yeah, totally buy into the niche thing. And yeah, we are this niche. And then I'll go and look on their website and they're hedging their bets. There's nothing on there clearly that says this is who we are, this is who we do it for, and this is what we do. And otherwise you look like, and with your services, you need to get clear about your specialism as well. Otherwise you look like the kind of the guy with a Mac going, which of these things do you want to buy? And you look like you're having shopping lists with, you know, price lists on them. And that's just not a smart way to operate. So I guess for you, it's a big conversation. And I think the thing people say to me is, I get it, Rob, but how do I go about niching?
I mean, it's always, it's whether our engagement is to help with, I don't know, headcount growth or profit growth or time or market expansion or additional services. It's really, really difficult to have those conversations without knowing who it is you do it for and what they're buying from you, you know.
Yeah.
Otherwise it's just we're everything to everybody, and we'll do some stuff, and hopefully we'll win that one big client in the future that allows us to employ, you know, another X number of people. But until then, we're just going to muddle our way through it.
I think every time I've worked with a client that has worked out what their niche is and then committed to that, gone to market with it, they're always, you know, come back a year later and go, Rob, that's the best thing we ever did.
Always. It just, everything becomes clearer. All of a sudden you see ahead of you, wow, these are where my clients hang out. These are the blogs they read, the events that they go to. This is the message. These are their problems. And, you know, like you say, the reality is, yes, we lose out on potentially some of this other stuff, but we get more of this stuff from this audience, and they're more likely to buy from us, and they're going to pay more for that service. That far outweighs the stuff that you'll lose by being a generalist.
Yeah, for sure.
You mentioned the other word I'd like to drill down on a little bit is systems. You know, the self-running agency has systems in place. What the hell is a system? I think it's a really, really misunderstood, and a lot of people, I think, associate systems with the software that we use, and I don't think it's that, right?
No, it's, and I think they also associate systems with bureaucracy and create, you know, kind of pushing creativity out the window and all the rest of it.
Yeah,
it's really interesting. I'm doing some work with one of my clients who's a branding agency, and we're doing some work on capturing their essence of how they do things, because they have this issue where they have two owners who are up here and they've got the rest of the team here. And we're trying to kind of get out of their heads exactly what is it, what's the process that you take a client through?
Yeah.
And it's producing a fantastic piece of work that would be a brilliant template for other people. That's kind of more like a system. So I think it's like capturing the way that you do things. So no matter who is working on the account, the client will get a consistent experience. That's one of the aspects of it. And I think then there's other aspects of looking at systems that make your agency run more efficiently. So, you know, this is leading us onto a whole other dangerous topic, but, you know, agencies need to have some kind of time recording systems in place to, and people may not agree with me on this one, but this is what I think, to measure their capacity and measure their efficiency and work out, you know, training needs and all that stuff. That doesn't mean we should be selling time to clients. That's an example of a system that I think an agency should be using. And, you know, back in my day, we did that in Excel spreadsheets, but today there are so many great apps and tools available to support that. So I think there's systems like that. And then I also think there's systems around account management and, you know, how you communicate with clients, what are the formal things that we do, like reporting and so on and so on. And if you want to scale, you have to do that. As much as you might think, I don't want to do it, or it's all in my head, there's a certain point where you have to say, okay, I have to get it out of my head and get it into some kind of documented, you know, documentation that I can use to share and to train other people. And of course, if you have these systems documented, imagine how easy it becomes, or how much easier it becomes to onboard a new member of staff.
So I'm going to name check a client of mine, a wonderful man called John, who works at an agency in Greece, and he's kind of handling a big change management program. And I was describing systems to him, and the metaphor that I use is it's like a restaurant, right? And you can be a Michelin-starred restaurant, or you can be McDonald's. And the thing that they have consistent is that they have a recipe and a method, you know, and that recipe is just enough. You know, the recipe doesn't say walk 10 steps to the fridge, open the fridge door, pull out the bottom drawer, grab the bag of carrots, walk to this, you know, it says chop the carrots and boil them for 10 minutes. It's just enough to ensure the consistency of output, whether you're a Michelin-starred restaurant, low volume, high margin, or McDonald's, you know, high volume, low margin. And what John suggested was, God, you're absolutely right. And what agencies need to move away from is what we have a lot of over here in Greece, which is tavernas. Right. And I think it's a brilliant metaphor for the majority of agencies, in that we have 10 tables in this taverna, and the taverna owner is the chef, is the maitre d', is the barman, is the waiter, and it runs around and perhaps, you know, shouts at two or three people and manages to get through the night with just enough chaos to deliver, you know, just the right amount of quality for that audience. But it can't scale, you know, all the strings are pulled by that taverna owner. And I think that's the level of detail, as I see it, you know, a recipe and a method.
Great.
That we can use in restaurants to move away from the taverna owner.
I'm going to borrow that because that is such a good analogy. And you know, the thing is, if you, as an agency, if you want to be the taverna owner, that's okay. Mm-hmm. But you have to be realistic about what that means, which is you're intrinsically involved in everything. You're not really going to grow, but you might look at how you can maximize everything you do. It's okay to make that choice, but what you can't do is make that choice and then say you want to grow, or make that choice and then be frustrated that people come and go, clients come and go. So I think, you know, and as I always say to everybody, is that there's no right or wrong way to kind of grow your agency in terms of your aspiration. It's like, if you're running your agency for 5 years, that doesn't mean you should be at 2 million turnover. That's what someone else wants, but you might want to have a lifestyle business that isn't that. But you just have to be realistic about, you know, if I want to be a taverna, then I'm going to have to be the cook, the chief washing up and everything else. But if I want to be a McDonald's, then, you know, what's the thing that they did is that they created standard operating procedures on how to make a burger. And they made sure that if you were in, you know, Los Angeles or New York or London or, you know, wherever, you were going to get a consistent burger. And I think that's, you know, that's their secret to their success. That's what every other burger joint back in the 50s or whenever it was didn't do that McDonald's did do.
Yeah. All right. One more question for you before we wrap up. If I'm a taverna owner and I've had enough, what's the first thing? What's the first domino I can push? You know, where do I start with getting on that journey to having a self-running agency? Because, you know, I'm in the middle of the woods and all I see is trees around me, and I can see the promised land out there, but it feels like a long journey. What's the how do I get started?
Well, this is a bit of a glib answer, but I would get some external help first of all, because I think it's very difficult to see the wood for the trees, and so people could be giving you external advice. So I'd get some external advice, but I would sit down and I'd literally grab a sheet of paper and I would say, where do I want to be in a year's time? And I would just write down the things that I want to do, and then I would say, okay, well, if I want that, what are the next things that I need to do? And I think that's quite hard sometimes to do on your own, but it's not impossible. You can do that. So I'd just have a plan, because, you know, if I'm running a taverna and I don't have a plan, then all I'm going to do is work day to day and make sure I've got enough fruit and veg to serve the clients that day. And I'm not it's not going to change. You know, if I want something to change, I've got to make a change myself. It's not going to magically change. So I'd say the first thing to do is literally grab a sheet of paper, sit down and say, where do I want to be in a year's time? And then say, okay, well, if I want to be there, and make sure that there is something you really want. Because sometimes people say they want this, but then they think about it and they realize they want that. Get a sheet of paper, write down where you want to be in a year's time, and then say, okay, in order to do that, what are the 5 changes that I need to start making today? One of the reasons why plans fail, why these kind of visions fail, is because people do that kind of bigger picture thinking, but they don't create a kind of a ladder from here to today. So what you've got to do is take your year vision and break it down into quarters, and break that down into months, and break that down into weeks and days. And if you do that, you're going to take every day, you're going to be taking a step forward. And one of the first things you might need to do is understand, what's the revenue I need to be at to hire a taverna manager? Because then the minute I've got someone good running the day-to-day aspects of my taverna, I can start taking a step back and actually getting that higher level helicopter view. So I guess that's what I would say the first thing to do.
I'd like to double down on that external advice piece. When I ran my agency, somebody said the word systems and processes to me, and I didn't reach out for external advice. I've still got the PDF that we created here, and I think it's something like 150 megabytes, this PDF. And, you know, to print it out and to see to be able to read the words, you'd need a sheet of paper as big as a tennis court. It is so overly complicated, you know, it describes everything that we do or try to describe everything we do from start to finish. We couldn't load it on the computers that we were trying to edit it on. It was too big and it served absolutely no purpose, and we never went back to it and we never edited it and we never read it as a consequence, you know. And it then took somebody else coming in and there's offloading all of this kind of stuff and then pointing out, well, yeah, but you know, these are the five steps that make the difference. Everything else kind of happens as a matter of course, you know, when those five steps happen. And that external simplifying view, I think, is incredibly powerful.
Well, there's one other really important point that you just made that's worth making, especially in the year that we've just had. And that is, when you create a plan, you have to make it living and dynamic. You have to say, what do we know today that we didn't know yesterday that impacts this plan? Because if you cast it in stone and look back at it in a year later, you're going to go, oh yeah, we didn't do that. And that's one of the biggest objections I hear from people about doing this process, because they go, yeah, we've done that before. We did 2 days off site. We came up with this beautiful thing. And then we all got back to our desk, got our head down and ignored it. So I think the pandemic has taught us that, you know, you have to keep looking at things and changing things because things change on a daily basis. So I also think, in this context, but just generally in business, keep it simple is the biggest motto. And the great thing about having external advice is you create some accountability. So you're not just doing that lovely diagram of your systems and processes, but now someone's holding you to account, which often the owners of agencies don't have, to get you to get that stuff done.
Lovely. Rob DaCosta from DaCosta Coaching. It's been an absolute pleasure speaking with you. I'm sure we'll speak again. Thank you for giving us your time today.
No, my pleasure.